Yeah, no, it was extraordinary. I mean, I thought it'd be terribly boring, like most conference speeches, but it was just fabulous. And I know a lot of people who are probably nicer than me felt very sorry for her. But I thought it was very, very funny.
It's a bad sign when a cough suite goes down better than you do.
She coughed so much, it felt like she was going to start coughing insects. like an actual horror film.
But it's that moment when you're talking to someone who doesn't really believe what they're saying, and they're saying, yes, I'm really the person for the job. And everything's going very...
Coughing does not do well for female politicians. Her and Hillary Clinton, yeah. Their colds have destroyed them.
Well, Ian Duncan Smith used to cough a lot. Mm. Do you remember? He was another successful Tory leader.
he never had it that bad, though.
No, you don't think so?
No, it's a sort of much lower level cough-based problem. Theresa May took it to... I mean, she weaponised. That was quite incredible. I can't believe you didn't feel any sympathy for her at all. Not even a scintilla.
Oh, dear.
I did.
I think I'm coming across as a bad person.
Awful. I only felt sorry for her because of Boris. I feel that she's... That was such a bad day that it was almost a win for Boris, and I feel that's the only... So I feel like I hate him so much that you want her to have a better gig, you know? Why don't she sack Boris?
She can't. She can't, can she, sack Boris?
Why?
Because if she sacks him, he gets to walk away from Brexit while simultaneously being able to claim that if he'd stayed in the government, it all would have gone much better than it's clearly going to go.
You know, she can't allow him the pleasure. It's like, you know, he's essentially an arsonist who wants to come back dressed as a fireman.
Yes. Yes.
Where's the fire?
There was one of her... So, I mean, she's been accused of being robotic, so one of the Conservative backbenchers today was making the rounds in the TV studio saying she's made of very strong metal, which I thought was...
Well, people say that at a certain point the Prime Minister runs out of luck. Mm. It just happens to you when everything's going wrong.
Yeah. It's like the end. It's like the complete end. She's not so much as occupying the office of Prime Minister, it's haunting it.
I mean, again, it's difficult to make up, but the first letter is F, so it's an F off.
An F off. 15% of respondents to a YouGov poll said that the speech had gone well. 15, which is, there's no way that could just be the cabinet. 15% of people. 15% of people watched that and thought, yes, that's gone rather well. Which makes you wonder what it would take to lower that number from 15%. She could have stood there and melted like the witch at the end of The Wizard of Oz. 12% think it went rather well. She's a puddle on the floor. 10% still think it's gone rather well. It's 15%.
Are you sure that isn't just members of the Labour Party? Former Prime Minister.
That's the 1922 committee. Yeah.
That's the Queen. No, that's Andrea Leadsom. Oh, God.
At time of recording, who's Prime Minister?
Boris Johnson.
It is currently Theresa May.
Oh, right, of course.
Yeah, but how bad have things got for Theresa May?
There's been another cabinet revolt. She won't even see her main ministers. She's now got a cabinet of two, herself and her husband. even he's walking out. Everyone's gone. Andrea Leadsom's gone, you saw there.
Do you know what number Andrea Leadsom is on the resignation list under Theresa May? How many have gone?
36.
She's the 36th minister. There's a graph from the BBC.
A graph on a comedy show. This is the third.
This is a graph of ministerial resignations before Theresa May, and here it is with Theresa May on it.
This is Theresa May's plan to end the Brexit deadlock. According to the Sunday Times, Philip May's emphasis has shifted to hoping his wife can escape from number 10 with dignity. Sorry, Phil, but however she finally goes, Colonel Gaddafi left with more dignity.
Quite right.
Brexit has clearly put a strain on Theresa May's marriage, but there's no way they'll split up, as Philip May knows negotiating a divorce deal would take years, and he'd need the support of Jeremy Corbyn. According to The Telegraph, MPs are sitting in the longest parliamentary session since the English Civil War. Or, as future historians will call it, English Civil War I.
The director.
Paisley pyjamas. Rather indeed. Small pattern. That's a middle-aged man. Mm-hmm. He's just enlarging it. Oh, dear. That's one of your lot.
Did you remember him?
Yes, he was Minister for Civil Society. And he was being very polite in his way.
This story is about a sting, isn't it? This is about a national newspaper, shall we call them the Mirror for the sake of argument, setting up a bloke look like a woman and really just sort of enticing a Conservative MP to do something that some people might say was unusual.
Yeah. Would you say it was unusual?
Well, I think it's... I have to say, in all fairness, to wear paisley pyjamas is completely unusual.
How did the Mirror justify the publication of this story?
They said it was really funny.
In fact, they said Brooks knew Mark was a legitimate target as he was the Minister for Civil Society and the founder of Women to Win, a campaign to get more females into politics.
It would only be hypocrisy if he was the Minister for Genital Concealment. I think there is a public interest.
The Sunday Mirror's editor vigorously defended the paper's actions, saying subterfuge was used in this investigation and we have been very clear about that from the start. So, presumably, the correspondence began, "Hello, I'm a male tabloid journalist, posing as a 21-year-old blonde woman. Would you mind sending me a photo of your penis, please?"
The director of the Paris Archdiocese, Philippe de Couverville, told The Times, "We tend to wait for things to become catastrophic before we take care of them." To which Theresa May replied, "Oh, you too."
If you really want to know what the members of the Cabinet are thinking, you have to watch Newsnight.
Yes.
And listen to Nicholas Watt.
I said to one Cabinet Minister, why is the Prime Minister holding a vote when she's pretty sure that she's going to lose? And using very strong language, this Cabinet Minister said to me, "Fuck knows, I'm past caring, it's like the living dead in here." Oh.
Following a tense meeting of the 1922 committee, evidence emerges as to who ate Sir Graham Brady's donut. Rees-Mogg was obviously very appalled by all this, but he does have his Facebook supporters group boost his morale. Have you seen his Facebook?
No, well, it's actually been outlawed because it's based in Broadmoor.
Let's have a look at this illuminating forum. Just for interest's sake, are there any young folk on this site? Yes, I'm 55.
What has Boris done for the second time in 6 months?
Nothing.
Gone home in the same direction?
Finally, 72-year-old becomes the oldest competitor in what?
Young Conservatives leadership.
So this is the news that scientists have released the first ever picture of a black hole.
Theresa May is very excited about this because it's a whole new entity out there with which we might do a trade deal in due course. And she's just glad there's another despairing vortex sucking in all human life and light from which there is no escape.
The next episode of the demise of Theresa May, who's gone from being the Iron Lady to a sort of flatter version, like the Ironed Lady, instead.
So nothing is happening. There was a big coup. We thought we were going to get, you know, a new Prime Minister, but no.
It's a bit like a very dull, slow Attenborough, isn't it? Where the same wounded wildebeest just keeps limping across the plain and the hyenas can't quite get organised enough to kill her off. Basically, what it is now.
Yes, it's about the week of plotting and infighting in the Tory party. Mm. There was speculation this week that Theresa might demote Boris Johnson in a reshuffle. Why might that not work?
He said he won't be demoted.
That's absolutely right. According to The Telegraph, allies of Boris warned that if May tried to demote him, he would just say no. We learnt more about the principal stance Boris Johnson took when he decided to back Brexit last year. What was that?
Well, he confessed to someone that he changed his mind and became a Leaver just to annoy Cameron.
Yeah.
Sorry. He confessed it in an interview.
Yes, yes, well, according to the Mail, so... Do you call that an interview?
Can we edit that bit out so people believe it?
Yeah. Well, according to a reputable paper...
Can we edit that bit out as well?
It was to Lord Adonis.
Lord Adonis.
Can you imagine being called Lord Adonis?
Hey.
It's quite a lot to live up to in the morning.
Lord Adonis. Yeah. That's my safe word. I'm only joking. You're never safe with me.
So as the good ship Theresa sinks slowly beneath the waves, who are the latest Tories to thrust themselves forward?
Oh, I don't like that expression. I don't think anybody in the Tory party can thrust. I don't think they've got their own hips. I think everyone who's been elected ever as a Tory thinks I could do a better job than Theresa May. I mean, they're not wrong.
I think you have to have a photo shoot in your kitchen to get into the race.
Yes. This is James Brokenshire. Here he is, with his Meg.
Oh, that is a lovely
That's
kitchen.
Him. I know. And he's Count got... the ovens, Tom. Count the ovens.
Four... Four ovens?
That we know of. There could be more.
There could be more that come...
It was George Eustace who quit as farming minister in February. So let's see a colleague in the Scottish Parliament's alarmingly frank assessment of him.
I personally have met with Andrea Leadison and I've had two meetings with George Eustace.
Evidence emerges to show why agreeing even the most basic of trade deals has taken Liam Fox such a long time. There's Gavin Williamson walking, which is something he's not denying.
And that's a brilliant bit of dramatised leaking.
Yeah. Oh, Helen Mirren's stuck for work. She's... Gavin Williamson has been fired for allegedly leaking secrets, but he swears on his children's life that it wasn't him. And he has been fired by Theresa May, which is unusual because she loves not firing people. Mm. She's a big fan of just letting people stay, Chris Grayling.
Normally, you know, if you sacked your defence secretary, it would be three volumes of a history book. But with this government, yeah, all right, he's gone.
Theresa May seems so definite that he did it that I'm assuming he didn't.
This is the news that Gavin Williamson has been sacked as Secretary of State for Defense over the Huawei leak. As The Guardian put it, Williamson is the first cabinet minister to go for a leak since 1986. How has Williamson responded?
He accused her of ingratitude. He said, I've saved your career twice, as though anyone's going to be grateful for that.
Yeah, that does mean prison, I think, if he admits to that.
I think maybe he did it, he just didn't realise, cos he seems very adamant that he did not do it. Yeah. If you're going to swear on your children's life, that's...
Yeah, I don't think we should hold him to that.
But he said it, Andy. Oh. He said it. Well, it's fine, though. He doesn't have any kids. There you go.
Not anymore.
Or he won't.
Johnny, yeah. You were in the army.
Yeah.
You sit on that committee. Is this a good idea?
No, I mean, it doesn't sound great, but the people who know this stuff seem to think it's all right, but, you know...
You don't sound totally lukewarm, even.
my political vim and vigour is on its last legs, I think. Much like the government.
The rest of the
Has anything happened?
Well, she's been to Brussels, and everything
has
changed.
Yeah, that happens every week.
People say, oh, we missed Brexit Day, March the 29th, it's not happened. But if you listen to what they're saying in Brussels, they're saying, well, actually, we might give you another extension and we can still have a Brexit Day. And there are some people there who think, well, let's have it every year, every single March the 29th. Theresa May or somebody like her will trot off to Brussels and say, we'll have another 12-month extension and Brexit will still definitely be happening, but we'll just sort of...
Yeah, you know. And we could tell everyone we've left and then just not mention it again.
Exactly. But Halloween, you know, is the next cut-off.
Do you think that was a joke by the Europeans?
I think it was a joke. But you've got Tory MPs going around saying, oh, well, we must dress up as something for Halloween, you know.
How about as MPs?
Well... Theresa Mayhem in a £900 coat. There she is, flying off to Brussels to be told what to do and say and think. The real Prime Minister.
On the left.
The traitor's kiss. The Politburo, or is that Bexley Heath Council? And a man on a bike.
What are the rival camps calling Jeremy Hunt?
Sounds like.
I got it. Apparently, Jeremy Hunt is called Theresa in Trousers. or TIT for short. Did you see how Liz Truss dealt with the question on LBC?
No, but I can't wait.
What do you think of having another EU referendum?
A very, very, very bad idea.
But people can change their minds, can't they?
But they were told in the referendum in 2016 that their vote would be implemented, and the reality is the vote needs to be implemented.
But what about the people who've changed their minds between then and now?
I don't think people have changed their minds. Everyone I speak to... I have, that's true.
Who are you backing in the Conservative leadership election?
There isn't one. There isn't a Conservative leadership
Should
election.
There be one in the near future, if that's something we can
I don't know if that's going to happen.
What are they doing running around trying to get each other's votes, then?
You're not going to believe this, but some of my colleagues are slightly more fixated with their own careers than what's going on in Brexit.
I know. Now, that is shocking.
Right. absolute shock. So, yeah, some people are running around trying to be Prime Minister at a time of national crisis.
Including Mrs. May.
Theresa May still have support among the grassroots outside the Westminster bubble. How did she get on in Wales this week?
She got heckled.
Yes, she did, didn't she?
Yep, she made a speech to local party activists. And everything went well for the first 5 seconds. Then...
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, and...
Why don't you resign?
Well, she did a bit of Welsh there. I mean, she knows how to say what a knobhead in Welsh, so that's handy. It was an amazing night for Jeremy Corbyn. Alan, you described him as useless, incompetent and incapable.
You're reading things into that, and this is... That's it. And it's... Typical of the mainstream media attacking. So his lop and his establishment paper, Public Eye, whatever it is.
Yes.
And you just make up these
Can I
things.
Just say at this point, I'd like to congratulate Jeremy on a very, very good campaign. I'm not serious. He was terrible, but he wasn't as terrible as her. That's all that matters.
Which
you start from a really low bar... Yes. A huge success. But he's now as successful as Gordon Brown was when he lost.
What's gone wrong? What did I do wrong?
No, nothing.
Right, nothing.
No, they're admitting it.
Are
it's
we moving
made
on?
Up.
No.
It's just what, today?
Yeah.
Well, extraordinarily, over the last 5 minutes, Chucker has actually withdrawn his candidacy from the Labour leadership.
To be in the most powerful programme on television. We haven't even gone out. At the moment we're appearing in front of 300 people, that's enough. To make a man withdraw his candidacy.
Oh, God.
Bad news, they've just shown your video on Have I Got News For You. I resign! I'm away, I'm off, I'm off.
Do we have any information why he resigned? Why he?
Yeah, Peston called him amateur. He's gone!
Labour necessarily lost because they were left. I think it's because they are all over the place. It was an awful campaign.
They're not anymore.
No.
They're mostly in London.
No, but I think Labour... Labour are like those restaurants that have really thick menus. You know, and they serve, like, Italian food, breakfast, Chinese. You think, I do not trust these guys. They're just all over the place. It's sort of responsive, and that's the problem. I think people... They should choose some Labour campaign, Labour ideals, and just sort of make them appetising again. Sell them.
How about her for leader?
Yeah. Yeah. I'd be terrible. I mean, if you think Ed was bad at eating a bacon sandwich, I'm practically feral.
That's your campaign poster. Practically feral.
Are you Labour anymore? No. I hadn't noticed that. They're going to rebrand.
Yeah. Labour.
Labour classic.
Yeah. They couldn't call themselves New Labour when Blair left. It's like when Mike Nolan left Bucks Fizz. They couldn't call themselves Bucks Fizz anymore.
Yeah. Labour could go with Bucks Fizz. Champagne socialists, but slightly diluted Fizz. With orange juice. And the Lib Dems? What are they?
I think they're going to sit this election out. Yeah. It's probably...
They've got a note from their mother. Yeah.
I think hopefully the sympathy vote, to a certain extent, just have Nick Clegg topless holding a puppy, just looking into the camera like that. Mm. I don't...
According to the Sunday Times, what has David Cameron decided to do?
Resign.
No.
Go on holiday.
No, this is about the TV debates.
He's going to debate with Nigel Farage. He's going for the toughest one first.
That's right. Cameron is going to take on Farage. According to the Sunday Times, Cameron wants the TV debates to be in a 2-3-5 formation. So that's Cameron Miliband, Clegg Miliband Cameron, and Farage Cameron Clegg Miliband with Yaya Touré behind the strikers. Thank you for laughing. I don't know what that meant.
Who are the two gangs in the Labour rivalry?
They're called Momentum. Mm-hmm. Which is the Corbynite one, and Progress, which is the other.
Like it's The Apprentice. Oh, my God, they've given themselves stupid names.
There is a serious side to this. The divisions in the Labour Party gave Cameron a much easier time on Wednesday than he should have had, because much of the debate was actually focused about the internal battles in the Labour Party, but it should have been focused on dismantling what was a threadbare case for bombing in Syria.
According to one embattled Labour MP, every day is like opening an advent calendar of shit.
Oh,
no. What did one of Corbyn's most loyal supporters, Diane Abbott, do in a shadow cabinet meeting?
Light an advent candle?
It'd be dangerous. According to the Sunday Times, Diane Abbott tried to do an impression of shadow education spokesperson Lucy Powell. One source told the Sunday Times she's no Mike Yarwood. The performance was so dire that Corbyn loyalist John Cryer considered voting for bombing just on the basis of her contribution.
How much do you blame Corbyn for the referendum result? You even thought Corbyn voted Leave, didn't you?
I think a lot of the arguments that Jeremy put helped the Leave campaign.
Do you still think he will go down in history as the man who broke the Labour Party, as you said?
Well, everything's to... The Labour Party's got to be mended, that's the truth, and I don't like Mrs May and the way she's leading the country, so I hope that Labour can pull itself together.
That's definitely not a straight answer to a straight
That was about as skew-if an answer as I could possibly give.
So...
Oh, Jeremy's in! Yeah.
I think people know you think Jeremy Corbyn's an idiot. I mean, you've said it so many times. Why stop now?
But there's plenty of people who move in and out of the shadow cabinet, and they've said even worse things than Chris has. So don't try and restrict his future career.
No,
I'm sorry.
No,
just by trying to get him to, you know, confirm what he's already said many times is pretty underhand. Mm. Leave him alone.
I'm a bit worried that Ian Hislop is supporting me. And,
I'm not. You know,
no, I'm...
Did you hear what he called you two?
Sickening capitalist lickspittles.
Pretty much. Sneering media commentariat.
I like the commentariat bit.
Yeah.
Just a Soviet hint there.
Why would he say that about you, Camilla?
I said that I was a little bit in love with him only 2 months ago, so I don't know why he would say that.
Well, I'll tell you the other things you've said about him is he is a turbo weirdo.
Correct.
A weaponized lentil. An extraordinary half recessive.
But anyway, this is the Labour conference. It didn't go as badly as everyone hoped. And in the end, Corbyn was not very good.
I have to say, I like him. I think as a person, I do. I like him as a person. I think if
have you met him though?
If he was on Bake Off, which is how I judge these things. First couple of weeks, you think, oh, I'm not sure about the grumpy. I'm not sure about Jeremy. Mm-hmm. Then you just go, oh, I love that. Wasn't it lovely when Elaine dropped that flan and Jeremy picked it up? I think if he was on. If he was on Bake Off and Cameron was on Bake Off, he would win the next election. I don't know if that's how they're doing if they do.
That's certainly news that the election's decided by Bake Off.
Ian, it's the new politics.
You're absolutely right, of course. It is the first conference for Corbyn as leader, and obviously it was slightly derailed at the end by this nuclear business.
Tell me about Trident. I understand the reason why we had Trident immediately after this, you know, the Bay of Pigs and the Cuban Missile Crisis. Why have we still got this? Why have we got this submarine? What is it protecting us from?
The originally it was.
Is it a tax on the underground?
No, nor tax on buildings. It was there originally to protect us against the Russians during the Cold War. And
but
I
that
suppose
sort of
one of the
now, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, but one of the things about this week is it just reminds you that the Russians are still there.
Yeah, but I've got a box of hay under my bed that keeps the elephants away. You know, it's the same thing with Trident. It's really difficult to prove that it's sort of doing what it's meant to have done.
It is very difficult to prove. I mean,
because
like
my box of hay doesn't cost 120 billion quid, you see. Yeah. Well, it does keep the elephants away.
No elephants.
No elephants.
Have we gone on question time?
CBeebies, I think.
Also, he was asked a straight question and he gave a genuine answer. They ask a question, which they always do for politicians. We'll ask him a question, it's impossible to answer. So, would you ever press the nuclear button? If you say no, then you have this reaction. If you say yes, you say what you've always said you wouldn't do. So he can't answer it. So what does he do? He actually told the truth.
Yeah.
And no one's done that for a long time.
No, we
haven't. Definitely question, John.
Whether he is right or wrong, I think that's quite a refreshing
way to deal
with it. I
think the problem was that he then changed his mind afterwards, which is not great if you've got your finger hovering above the nuclear button, to be fair.
I had a bit of sympathy when he said he'd never press that button under any circumstances, because I'm the same with the ITV2 button on my remote.
What is ITV2?
You will find out soon enough, Jeremy.
Just rotate your televisions for this. Here's the first one.
Beep.
Buzz.
Yes, that's Jeremy Corbyn waving goodbye as his tenure as leader of the Labour Party is coming to a close. His watch is facing the wrong way, but he's saying goodbye, having sort of lost heavily at the last general election.
Yes. This is the very bad news for the Conservative Party that last week Jeremy Corbyn stood down as leader of the opposition. What did Corbyn finally admit to last week? Ian.
He admitted that he'd been right all along and that the country was now in a perfect socialist state in which the government paid everyone's wages, there were police on the streets arresting you for going outside, and it was what he'd always wanted. It was a pity it had taken a virus to do it, but apart from that, he'd been absolutely right all along.
How did Corbyn sign off his last PMQs as Labour leader?
He sent a letter to Boris Johnson which outlined his 5-point plan for what he thinks Boris Johnson should do, but there was only one problem with it. It had 6 points.
Well, he's not the only one in the party who can't count, is he? No.
Ooh. Someone's entered Miles' house.
I think someone's moving furniture. Yeah. I'll find out when this is over.
It's the bailiffs.
What will we all remember about Jeremy Corbyn?
The number of people who wouldn't let him finish.
Probably when he did this.
Private rented, poor lives.
Why are you remaining neutral?
Can I finish, please? Areas that have different views on it, as indeed...
So you when bring Brexit voices in?
Can I finish? Thank you. I think we've fought a very good piece of opposition to what the government's been doing.
Leave voters, Jeremy. Leave voters may argue that they are betrayed.
Can I finish? Please.
I think you have. With everything that's going on in the world, this is the story that's dominated the front page of the Morning Star. Jeremy Corbyn says the government's unprecedented financial bailout proves that he was right. Really? I don't remember him predicting a worldwide pandemic because some bloke in China ate a mongoose. Also, still in the race are Rebecca Long-Bailey and Lisa Nandy. Really, though, I thought they'd shut all the Nandys.
Right, round two. The picture spin quiz. Fingers on buzzers. Here you go. Richard, what's this about?
This was the news that Keir Starmer was elected leader of the Labour Party, replacing Jeremy Corbyn, and replacing indeed a lot of Corbyn supporters in the shadow cabinet as he went along. And his he made it a big priority to reach out in particular to the Jewish community, which he felt the previous regime had perhaps alienated a little bit. I think getting circumcised live on the One Show was taking it a bit far. But we look forward to a newly revived relationship between the Labour Party and its traditional Jewish members.
But very traditional members, if he's got circumcised.
Yes, this is the news that Keir Starmer has been elected the leader of the Labour Party after winning a landslide victory. The New Statesman described the scale of the win as unexpected. Yes, the words Labour and landslide victory don't often go together. What has his convincing victory allowed Keir Starmer to change?
Well, a lot of the cabinet, the shadow cabinet. Sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. It's the government of national unity. By the time you see this, we may have one. Keir Starmer may have stepped in. It wouldn't be a bad idea. But he's got rid of a lot of old Corbynites.
Yes, notable departures include Richard Bergen, who last year gave us so many wonderful moments, like this one.
We want the Tories out as soon as possible. We want to sort out Brexit. We also want to sort out austerity, which has lasted for 9 years.
Polls say you won't win.
Pardon?
The polls say you won't win.
The polls said we wouldn't win last time.
You didn't.
But I...
Speaking about Bergen's departure, one MP told The Sun this week, I just feel sorry for the village that's getting its idiot back. Who is back in the shadow cabinet?
Ed Miliband's back.
He is. The Sun in particular was delighted to see Ed Miliband return to frontline politics. What pun headline did they welcome his appointment with?
Miliband of Brothers.
Milli Vanilli.
Yeah.
Milli Vanilli.
Brilliant.
It was later discovered that Ed Miliband was miming to his own speeches.
They went with, look who's back, Bacon.
Ooh.
Strictly speaking, is that a pun?
It's not really a pun, is it? It's more a collection of words that don't really belong together.
And you have to remember a photograph of him eating bacon.
They did print that snap next to the headline. Here it is. Yeah. Unable to eat a bacon sandwich. The last time the Labour leader was in step with the Jewish community. This is the news that Keir Starmer has been made leader of the Labour Party. You must have noticed it. It was all over page 19 of the Mirror. One of Keir Starmer's first decisions as leader was to appoint Ed Miliband as the shadow business secretary. Ed is currently in isolation. Nothing to do with the virus, it's just his family still won't talk to him after he shafted his brother. Keir Starmer also appointed leadership rival Wigan MP Lisa Nandy to the role of Shadow Foreign Secretary. She'll now be in charge of dealing with parts of the world foreign to Labour, like the North.
Richard, here's another for you.
Oh, yes, of course, it's the flag of the European Union, we know that. Nigel Farage, and he's on his way to a public ceremony. Gays are allowed to get married for since Sunday. That's fantastic. Really good news, brilliant. And this couple here are amongst the first to actually, you know, say the rights. They're now a husband and husband. Fantastic news.
Oh, it's lovely.
It's a lovely story.
A lot of people think it won't last, but I'm all for it.
I think so. They've had a couple of arguments, a couple of them in public, but, you know, they'll get together as a couple. They'll be absolutely fine.
I think it's the story about Nick Clegg and Nigel Farage having a TV debate.
And who do you think won?
I don't think either of them are truly winners, are they? I think you've got best loser.
According to Donald McIntyre in The Independent, journalists had been briefed that Nick Clegg was going to do something unusual during the debate. What was it?
He was going to show some passion.
Get emotional.
On a space hopper.
And did he get emotional?
He got a bit emotional.
He used his hands a lot, didn't he? Sort of, you know, just to show emotion and stuff. He took his shirt off as well, I think, didn't he?
As far as I understand it. They wrestled like men. I quite enjoyed the debate. I think because of the way I watched it, because I didn't watch the pictures, I just had the audio. Then I turned the volume right down. And genuinely, I enjoyed it.
Well, it's slightly odd. You're the Deputy Prime Minister and you're taking on live television, a man who hasn't got one MP. And he wins. Mm. You know, this is supposed to be equal status.
Apparently, Clegg told Farage, you're making things up to make a point, to which Farage replied, you've done pretty well out of it.
Did you watch the debate last night?
Yes, I did. It was great. It was No. You caught me out mid-lie, mid-question. I didn't see it, no. Was it good?
So am I the only one who could bear to watch?
Yes.
Well, it was great.
What was your favourite bit, Ian?
The bit at the beginning when you realised Cameron hadn't turned up. That was very good. And then Clegg hadn't come either.
Yeah.
So it meant that everyone attacked Ed Miliband. He'd managed to get a platform where all the other people could say, you're useless. And he couldn't say it's the Tories' fault because they weren't there. So it was a slightly unbalanced debate.
But what do you think about David Dimbleby's frank confession at the end? mean, did you guess?
Ill-advised.
Ill-advised, yeah. I agree, I am.
Even though we didn't see all of the debate, let's have a look at the highlights.
There just seems to be a total lack of comprehension on this panel, and indeed amongst this audience, which is a remarkable audience, even by the left-wing standards of the BBC. I mean, this lot's pretty left-wing.
Hang on a second. Nigel, let me just say one thing. Yeah. This is an audience that has been carefully chosen, not by the BBC, but by an independent polling organisation to represent the balance between all parties.
It's never a great
time. Very good.
It's a very good tactic. Attack your audience.
Was it a wise move to pick a fight with David Dimbleby?
And the BBC audience. He's been a bit rattled, isn't he? 12 months ago, he was seen as this sort of man that was going to remake English politics and all this sort of stuff, and now he's just some bloke moaning that everybody's against him.
Who would you rather have a fight with, John? David Dimbleby or Jeremy Paxman?
Glass jaw, Dimbleby.
No, I think that...
He'd go straight down. Paxman, he'd be like a bulldog. You'd have to shoot him in the end. He'd keep coming. And another thing, Prime Minister. Last week we weren't on because it was children with knees. Mm. And we had... but I obviously have not read a paper, so this just sounds all so absurd.
Oh, there's more.
Is there more?
Yeah, Trump's proposed to the Queen. And she's accepted, and the wedding is next year. They're going to have it in Trump Tower. It's going to be fantastic.
Oh, I look forward to it.
Yeah, I'm best man.
Are you?
He hasn't actually appointed him.
But via Twitter. I mean, that's real, isn't it?
The president isn't actually allowed to appoint our ambassador yet.
No. Thankfully not.
Not on Twitter. If he does it on Facebook, it's legally binding. Oh, yeah.
So it was a late night tweet from Trump. Do you remember roughly what it said?
It said that many people think that Nigel Farage would make an excellent ambassador between the UK and the US, or
that's
something
many
along
in the sense
almost.
Of yeah. One.
I responded to Donald Trump and I said, name them.
This is exactly what he said. Many people would like to see Nigel Farage represent Great Britain as their ambassador to the United States. He would do a great job.
Donald Trump doesn't even follow Nigel Farage on Twitter, which is a massive digital slap
That's
in the face.
Hard.
Yeah,
really.
Yeah, he doesn't even follow him, so he doesn't think he's that great a job. He doesn't think he's got top bants online.
Do you know?
Can everyone remember? You remember Christopher Mayer, who was Tony Blair's ambassador
yes.
to the US?
Yeah.
Do you remember what his instruction was?
Yeah. Get as drunk as possible and then avoid everybody.
It was pretty nearly that.
Was it?
He was told to get as far up George Bush's arse as you can.
Exactly. It was exactly. We want you to go.
Is he allowed to use crampons? Is he?
We want you to get up the arse of the White House and stay there. So that's the brief. Actually, maybe Nigel Farage is qualified.
Well, Blair did it himself. He didn't actually need an ambassador.
Now, who'd like to see a picture of Farage, quite possibly the happiest moment in his life? I think that's the door into Trump Tower.
It hinges. Is fantastic. Have you seen the pictures of inside? It's sort of late Gaddafi, the day. Perhaps early Saddam, but it's a riot of vulgar dictator chic. It is.
Meanwhile, how is Theresa May's special relationship with Trump coming
Very
along?
Very good.
Very good. He said to her, if you're ever over, do drop in.
Let me know.
Made that up. That was it.
If you're coming over, let me know.
Know.
That's what you say to the couple you don't like on holiday, isn't it? right, and that welcome interruption means it's time once again for a bonus buzzer election round, so let's get started. And the category is... Where am I? I'm UKIP parliamentary candidate for Birmingham, Harjinder Singh, but where am I?
He's in the street.
He's in the street.
Well, he is, of course, standing near Junction 7 of the M6. He's waving at passing cars. He's been doing this 13 hours a day for the last 2 weeks in a bid to win votes. Locals in a nearby pub were asked if they were going to vote for UKIP. What did they all reply?
No.
No, there we are. Fingers on buzzers. Here is your next question.
Are we allowed to do jokes about UKIP? I thought we'd been referred to the Kent police.
Yeah. After last week's show.
Mm. And the police were very rightly quite surprised. I mean, usually they're investigating UKIP, not following up complaints. But anyway, well, I hope we're going to be jolly careful, because it's the Representation of the People's Act. So if you make jokes about Farage,
or UKIP, they could well complain.
Well, he's already threatening the BBC, isn't he, to slash the licence fee as a revenge for that audience on the opposition.
But it's funny when anyone says that, you know, there were some pretty racist jokes made at, say, the UKIP gala. He says, oh, it was a joke, we're going to have censorship now. I think the Kent police are going to be round again. Yeah.
Next, here's UKIP parliamentary candidate for the West Midlands, Claire Braund. Can you tell me what happened next?
Did she start singing, let it go, let it go?
You are so close. I mean, that is almost exactly right. Yes, let's...
No!
Let's just have a look.
This is the rhythm of the night. Oh, yeah. The rhythm of the night. This is the rhythm of my life. My life. Oh, yeah. The rhythm of my life.
Why?
Why? Ian? That's a no from me.
What the parties on the poll is for the latest YouGov European election poll?
But 38% UKIP.
It's 31% UKIP, Labour 28 and Tories 19. Were you surprised by that, Bridget?
Yes, I thought it had gone up 7 points today.
You haven't been watching carefully enough.
Oh, has it gone back down again?
Well, I check it more frequently than you.
Have you got a Google alert?
Yes, I have, yes.
That's despite... That's, I mean, UKIP come in for constant bashing around the clock. No matter what you do, they get stronger.
Mm.
It's like... there's no point attacking them. It's like trying to piss in a lake constantly to make it go away.
Yeah.
What are Nuttall's plans?
To hold the government to a hard Brexit.
Mm.
And yes, if Mrs May at any point goes soft, Nuttall will be there.
Yeah.
That's the motto. Don't go soft, Nuttall's watching.
Yeah.
We definitely want a hard Brexit. It's got to be hard to be good. Everybody knows that.
This is pornographic.
And he offers a panto this year.
Of course, there are the shockingly high EU immigration figures that have just come out.
Yeah, record EU immigration figures today.
They're all coming over! Oh, there'll be some in here, Suzanne! Take cover under the desk! Oh, my God! Strange accents and everything!
You see, this is a fundamental misunderstanding about UKIP. We're not anti-immigration at all. We just want to... It's true.
You see, that's the problem with the message. It hasn't really got across.
No.
Oh, Miss Maria Miller. She's gone, going into a house, not hers.
Oh, she's changed her outfit.
No, there's another house. That's probably hers. Oh, and it's a duck house. That's where she put her parents to live. No, he doesn't think that's funny either.
She's resigned.
She's gone. She said it was because she'd brought in gay marriage and the evil press were out to get her. But, you know, that's unfair, because, yeah, we were. But she did actually threaten The Telegraph when they brought it up. One of her assistants said, my boss is in charge of Leveson and press behaviour. The reason she went is the public are furious. They've had enough of MPs claiming expenses, and it's very damaging for everyone, isn't it, Nigel?
Nigel, what do you think about her resigning?
On the basis she doesn't even know where she lives, I wouldn't have thought she's fit to be in the cabinet, would you? So I'd say good riddance, frankly. I think it's absolutely disgusting, all these elected politicians using all these expenses to better themselves. It's disgraceful, isn't it, Ian?
It is absolutely disgraceful, Mr Kettle.
So why was Cameron so reluctant to get rid of her?
He didn't want to look weak. He didn't want to lose one of the women in his cabinet. And he doesn't like being told what to do. And he's indecisive. And he's hopeless.
It's not like the real world, is it? She's sort of lost her job, but she's just gone to the back benches. So it's not like... It's like school. She had to stand up and say, sorry for my attitude, and then got told to sit in the back of the class.
She was a woman who went to a comprehensive, so he's done pretty well to communicate with her up till now, let's face it.
And in her resignation, she apologised. She said she was leaving because she'd become a distraction.
Yes.
Which is quite... Cats in tights on the internet are a distraction.
The
press kept commissioning opinion polls, all which said she should quit. This is something David Cameron had actually told his MPs to think about when the expenses scandal broke in 2009. Subject yourself to the Daily Mail test. How would this...